Here we discuss concepts of diprotic and polyprotic acids. So di, of course, meaning two, protic meaning there's a proton in here, poly meaning many. So we're talking about acids that have two or more protons on them. And we are still only transferring one proton at a time. So the number of protons in an acid will determine the number of ionization or dissociation equations that we have to write. Each successive ionization, each step as we remove a proton, has its own Ka value associated with it. For our example, we're going to work with carbonic acid. So notice we have two protons in here. But as this dissociates in water, of course it's weak, we only dissociate one proton at a time to produce hydronium. So this has a Ka value that we label as Ka1. We're removing the first proton, and it doesn't technically matter which one in the structure. We're just removing the first one. And this would have, of course, our expression of products over reactants. And for Ka1 for carbonic acid, it has a value of 4.2 times 10 to the minus 7. So we have a second ionization equation that can be shown. Realize that hydrogen carbonate can act as both the conjugate base of carbonic acid, or it can act as an acid in our second ionization equation. Again, still weak. Now we're pulling off that second proton to produce carbonate. This is still acting as an acid here, so we produce more hydronium. And now we have a Ka2 expression. And the key thing to recognize with di and polyprotic acids is the relative values of your Ks. So Ka1 has an exponent of 10 to the minus 7. Ka2 has an exponent of 10 to the minus 11. This relationship is always true for any di or polyprotic acid. So one of the key things you should recognize is A, not only how to write each equation for a polyprotic acid, but also to recognize the first K value is always going to be the largest. The second value is going to be smaller. The third and the fourth get successively smaller as we dissociate more. In other words, this second equation is a much weaker acid than carbonic acid. We would produce much less hydronium from this second ionization. As an example, in Appendix H, we see constants, the Ka values for polyprotic acids. And again, not to memorize these, but just notice the pattern as we go from Ka1 to Ka2 to Ka3, that these change by several orders of magnitude each time. Citric acid is probably the closest one, going from a minus 4 to a minus 5. Other than that, they change by multiple orders there. And recognize sulfuric acid, of course, our first proton is considered strong. The second one is considered relatively weak, not horribly weak, but relatively weak. So in addition to the relative K values, the second thing to recognize about solving for the pH of a di or polyprotic acid is that we need to set up an ice table for every dissociation. So if I have two protons here, I should set up two ice tables. But we have a shortcut to see at the end, but I want to show you the work for it. So here's our ice table set up. We have our expression. We assume that X is small. And so when we solve for X, we get this value. So our initial carbonic acid doesn't change at all, but we do have values of hydrogen carbonate and hydronium in here. So realize that in our second dissociation, these will actually become the initial concentrations when we set up our second ice table. So notice Our starting point for hydrogen carbonate is the X we saw for in the previous screen, and we start with a value of hydronium now. So to solve for this one, we're plugging into Ka2, where we have a much smaller value. Once we get all of our setups in here, we get this math equation. So recognize the interesting thing here is that we have both a plus X in the numerator and a minus X in the denominator. Both of those can go to zero. And so hopefully you recognize that then that means that these numbers can just cancel out. And so our X value actually ends up equaling our Ka2 value. That means our total concentration of hydronium from both ionizations is the sum of the first step plus the second step. But the second one is so small that when we add them together, we really just get the concentration from our first ionization. And so that's how we calculate pH. So the moral of all of this is that we really only need to set up one ice table for a di or polyprotic acid. And that's because the second, third, and fourth dissociations would be so small that those hydronium concentrations wouldn't contribute much. And so only the first ionization equation contributes appreciable amounts of hydronium. And so again, the two takeaways are this one, that pH can still actually be solved from just one ice table because of the degree of dissociation in successive equations, and that your first K value is always going to be the largest, and they get successively smaller as we remove protons.